بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله إلا بالله العلي صلى الله عليك يا سيدي ويا مولاي يا رسول الله صلى الله عليك وعلى آل بيتك المعصومين المظلومين لعن الله الظالمين لكم من الأولين والآخرين والصلاة والسلام على الصديقة الشهيدة المظلومة ذات الآلام الكثيرة في المدة القصيرة ألا لعن الله من ظلمها ظلمها وغصب حقها وآذاها وعاداها وعادى ذريتها وشيعتها ومن والاها ما خاب من تمسك بكم وأمن من لجأ إليكم سادتي فيا ليتنا ثم يا ليتنا كنا معكم فنفوز فوزا عظيما السلام على من عظم الله قدرها سلام على من عظم الله قدرها يا وأعلى علاها فهي أنسية حورا سلام على الزهراء ما ناح نائح وما صدحت ورقاء في أيكة قفراء وعرج على قبر النبي بيثرب وصح معولا والعين باكية عبرا وقف عنده دام الفؤاد بحسرة وقل يا أبا الزهراء قد ماتت الزهراء peace be upon her whom Allah honored and raised her status as she was an angelic human peace be upon Zahra as long as a weeper weeps and as long as a bird in the vacant forest chirps and turn towards the grave of the prophet in Yathrib and scream lamenting with watery eyes full of tears, and stand beside it with a broken heart, distressed, and say, O Abba Zahra, Zahra has died. She died as bitter miseries has stirred her heart. Hey, yeah, she had not reached 20. How short was her age? Her age, your loss has filled her heart with sadness and time tormented her, after caused her pain. Caused her pain. So ask her the details of her miseries. Perhaps it reduces the anguishing pain of her burning heart. Ask her what is the story behind the nail. Ask her lungs the story behind the nail. They will inform you of the state of she who was crushed, and about Mohsin. Ask her, what sin did he commit that he deserved the cup of death? And ask her earring, why did it break? Was it because a hand pulled them by force? Did your ears bleed, my daughter? What pain did you feel after being crushed and your face slapped? Ask her back why it has dark marks. Was it due the whip? Ask her eyes why they turn red. Was it due to the slap or constant mourning? Or was it because of her burning heart that they turned red like burning coal? Buried at night in darkness, and her grave is a secret. Her masaib would turn days into nights. Lawla suqut janin Fatimatin lama hawda laha. وبكسر ذاك الضلع روضة ضلع في طيها سر الإله مصون. إنا لله وإنا إليه راجعون. قال الله تبارك وتعالى في محكم كتابه العزيز: بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، واستعينوا بالصبر والصلاة وإنها لكبيرة إلا على الخاشعين. To hasten the appearance of our 12th Imam, perfume our Majlis, Enlighten our hearts with the loud salat ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad. My dear brothers and sisters, the mawaleen of Sayyidah Zahra salamullahi alayha and of Ahlulbayt, my condolences and these nights that we have been remembering Our Lady Sayyidat Nisa al-Alameen in these days of Fatimiyya, and we have tried to learn from the life of Our Lady. Can remove the echo kindly, please. Yesterday, in the beginning, I was talking about the 10 different opinions considering what secret Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had hidden in Sayyidah Zahra salamullahi alayha. But because of the fact that the practical side of the seerah and the biography on the life of Sayyidah Zahra salamullahi alayha is so important, I focused on the second part of my lecture in trying to dive into the practical lessons from the lives of Ahlulbayt alayhim salam. And I mentioned that we are blessed considering the fact that alhamdulillah, since the time of the Holy Prophet and his strategic planning in any prisoner who knew how to write, offering them freedom if they were to teach 10 Muslims how to read and write, he was able to wipe out illiteracy, or to reduce it to a really high extent, to the level that alhamdulillah today all of the knowledge, so much of the knowledge of Ahlulbayt alayhim salam, has reached us, including the small details of how they lived. Today's lecture, again, it follows the same methodology, which is that it is not only going to be a scientific lecture per se. There are many different scientific topics if you were wanting to learn from Ahlulbayt alayhim salam that we can speak of, but this would be unfortunately depriving ourselves from the practical benefits and the advice and the guidance that we can learn and attain from Sayyidah Zahra salamullahi alayha. It's really easy to have discussions, for example, to compare her istifa, that is to say the divine choosing of Sayyidah Zahra salamullahi alayha, and how the concept of divine choosing has been presented in the Holy Quran, and comparing her to Sayyidah Maryam. It is really, really easy to go to the narration that says that if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he becomes angry when Sayyidah Zahra salamullahi alayha is angry. At that, we can look at this on a tawhidi perspective. That is to say, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, does he have feelings? Does he react? And it's simple to go into many of these discussions. But the practical side is extremely important. At that, first of all, yesterday I talked about the fact that the chastity of Sayyidah Zahra salamullahi alayha, even in the way that she lived, this was something unparalleled. People at that time, they had not seen such level of a woman being so chaste, so pure. And this is something that I said we can learn from in our lives today and practice and see what kind of modern applications her chastity can have. Secondly, is the matter of salat. Salat, my dear brothers and sisters, which is the pillar of our religion, over 1,200 ayat from the Holy Quran, they talk about salat, like I forget if I had mentioned or not, but over 1,200 verses of the Holy Quran are related to salat. Why is this? This is because of the fact that salat, it is the main wajib, the main farida, the main obligation. If a person focuses on their salat, whatever other problems you have, salat has such a huge taqweeni, existential, metaphysical, spiritual effect that it will start to pull you towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sometimes even without you even intending it, but it will start to pull you. That in one of the narrations it is said that the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa alim, Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa ala Muhammad. He was in a mosque, he was in Medina, and he saw a youth praying, and his ibadah was really nice, so the Holy Prophet, he became really happy with that.
And he, it seems that he praised his ibadah. At that, some of the ashab who knew this youth, they said that, oh Rasulullah, this guy is a thief and he does 1, 2, 3, 4. The Holy Prophet turned towards them and he tells them, don't worry, his salat is going to rescue him. It's from the Holy Prophet. The modern application. One of my teachers, he narrates, if I remember the details of this story correctly, Sayyid Abu al-Hasan al-Isfahani, radwanullahi ta'ala alayhi, he was one of the grand marajas in Najaf al-Ashraf, approximately the 50s. During his time in one of the cities, there was a police commissioner who was known to be extremely, extremely cruel and ruthless with the local people over there, especially followers of Ahlulbayt alayhim as-salam. At one time, these people, they go to visit Sayyid Abdul Hassan al-Isfahani and they tell him, Sayyidina, we are having a lot of problems with this person. He is causing us a lot of adhiya, a lot of pain. He's tormenting us. At that, Sayyid Abdul Hassan al-Isfahani tells these people, no problem, call him to come to meet me. This person, these were, they go and they give and deliver this message of Sayyid Abdul Hassan al-Isfahani to that particular police commissioner. So that person became shocked. Sayyid Abu al-Hassan al-Isfahani wants to meet me. Khair, inshallah, no problem. Let's go see what this marja of yours wants to say to me. But wait, give me a period, maybe a few weeks, so that my beard can grow and then I can go to meet him. Because of course, to shave the beard, I mean, this is haram. And it is wajib for a man to have a beard. Hala, this person, he lets his beard grow. These zuwar in one of the visits, they take this person, this police commissioner, to meet Sayyid Abu al-Hassan al-Isfahani. Sayyid Abu al-Hassan al-Isfahani, he was really, really kind and soft-mannered with that person, with that police commissioner. How are you? And he embraced him. How is everything? You must be having a lot of problems in this economical situation. No problem, I'll solve your case for you. Don't worry about it. What Sayyidina tells him, look, I will order. How much is your salary? He said, a certain amount. He said, no, this is not enough. I'll order a certain amount, maybe the same amount of it than exactly his salary, or two times that amount. I'll order for my wakil to start to give it to you, and I'll give you this particular instruction, a paper, so that you can receive this from my wakil in that area. You don't even have to bother to come to Najaf. This police commissioner became happy and told him. He became really happy. Thank you very much, Sayyidina. Jazakumullah. But Sayyid Abu al-Hassan al-Isfahani was wise. He told him, but look, this money that I'm giving you, this money can only be taken by a person who prays Salat. So the condition for you receiving this money is for you to pray Salat. He said, no problem at all, inshallah, Sayyidina Taban, of course. As he was leaving the door, he tells that person who had brought him that zayr, that wait, you have to teach me how to pray properly. And it is said that after that person, after this incident of him, Sayyid Abu al-Hassan telling him, Abu al-Hassan al-Isfahani telling him that you have to start to pray, his way of, his method and his approach to the people over there, the way he treated them, it changed totally. It totally changed because of Salat. At that, Salat is something really important. And this is advice that I give to my brothers and sisters. Some of us, we may have problems with maybe some certain Salat, not praying them on time. So especially this is a problem with Salat al-Fajr, a really big problem. I do advise you, my dear brothers and sisters, whatever you want, and this is the advice of some of the Arafa, Sayyid Ali al-Qadir, he says that if you pray when the time of Salat starts, awwal al-waqt, yani, in the beginning of the time of Salat, he who prays during this time and they do not reach the highest levels of Irfan, let them come and curse me. Let them come and curse me. The way we live, unfortunately, we have become so accustomed to only material sensations, material pleasures, a material life. We totally forget, this is something I alluded to a few nights ago, we totally forget the soul. Know and understand the sensations, even the good feelings that this soul bears is totally unparalleled. It's something not found in this material world or in material things. It's not the pleasure that you can find in praying, especially in the morning, to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This you will not find it neither on Facebook, nor on Netflix, nor by eating cake or anything else. This is totally different. That pleasure, that sensation, you will feel a certain light with salat. So this, my advice to my dear brothers and sisters, this is one of the lessons that we learn from Sayyidah Zahra salamullahi alayha, that when she would be in her mihrab praying, her light would shine, according to the narration, that why she was called Zahra, her light would shine for the people of Al-Malakut, for the angels, just like the light of stars shines for the people of the earth. That is how she would shine. In other words, this is actually a metaphor for the fact that she was able, her salat was so pure, it was so malakuti, that she was able to transcend to that fire, to the higher realms in her salat. At that, this is something we have to try and always strive by. We want to be true followers of Sayyidah Zahra salamallahu alayhi. We claim to be true followers of Sahib al-Zaman alayhi salam. We have lost 124,000 prophets. 313 of them, according to narrations, had 12 successes. So multiply that as well and add that as well. In addition to, or among them are our 11 imams, we just have one infallible remaining. We, our generation, the people of Al-Ghaiba, we do not have that liberty of making mistakes. We don't have the liberty. Maybe the people before that, they had trial and error, margin for trial and error. We don't. You're either here or either there. In the middle, our Imam alayhi salam, this is not enough. This is not what he needs. He needs people who are ready, steadfast, who are firm. طيب, some of the secrets, what can assist us? My dear brothers and sisters, know that we can seek assistance for our wajibat through mustahabbat. Wajibat through mustahabbat. With regards to the story of Nabi Yaqub salamullahi alayhi, Nabi Yusuf and his brothers, after they did what they did, and finally they were exposed in front of their father, so they go and they seek his forgiveness. And they also say, "Oh father, you please as well, do istighfar for us." What does the father, what does Nabi Yaqub alayhi salam respond? Look at the verses. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. فَلَمَّا أَنْ جَاءَ الْبَشِيرُ أَلْقَاهُ عَلَى وَجْهِ فَرْتَدَّ بَصِيرًا. When they were exposed, when that brother who brought glad tidings and he brought the shirt of Nabi Yusuf salamullahi alayhi back to Nabi Yaqub, and Nabi Yaqub alayhi salam could now see, he had been blinded before that. قَالَ أَلَمْ أَقُلْ لَكُمْ إِنِّي أَعْلَمُ مِنَ اللَّهِ مَا لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. Did I not tell you that I know from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that which you do not know? قَالُوا يَا أَبَانَا إِسْتَغْفِرْ لَنَا ذُنُوبَنَا إِنَّا كُنَّا خَاطِئِينَ. Oh father, please kindly seek forgiveness for us for our sins. We were truly in disarray. We were truly wrong. What does Nabi Yaqub say? Bismillah. He says, قَالَ سَوْفَ أَسْتَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ رَبِّي. That I will seek forgiveness for you from my Lord. According to what our mufassirin, they say, سَوْفَ أَسْتَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ رَبِّي. I will seek forgiveness means that he delayed seeking istighfar until the time of sahar. That is to say, before the time of dawn. Those final few hours. And that third of the night. Night is divided into three thirds. And according to the understandings of our narrations, it is mustahab, it is good for a person to remain awake for the first third, to sleep for the second, and to wake up for the final third. However much of it is possible, of course, everybody, according to their lives, their circumstances, their strength. So Nabi Yaqub told them, I will seek istighfar for you from that time. My brothers and sisters, you want to feel spirituality? You want to truly feel that change in yourself? Today, after attending this lecture, before Salat al-Fajr, by a few minutes, half an hour, get up, open Mafatih al-Jinan or any of the books of Ad'iyah, Masbah al-Masbah al-Kafami, or any of the du'as, any of the books of du'as. Read. Read any du'a. Crave for reciting a du'a. And open any du'a book from the bottom of your heart. Sahifa Sajadi, anything. And recite the du'a on the Musalla. You will find the benefits of this time. It is narrated from Imam Al-Askari Salamullahi Alayhi that Al-Wusulu ila Allah Safarun la yudraku illa bimtita'il layl. That is to say that to reach to Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, this is a travel that, or this is a journey that cannot be reached. You can't reach your destination except by riding the night. Except by riding the night. None of the awliya, none of the prophets have been able to reach that stage and that level except through benefiting from this time. And this is mentioned in the Holy Quran in so many verses as well. That tatajafa junubuhum. And those people whose sides, they vacate their beds. Tatajafa junubuhum anil madaji'i. What do? Their sides vacate their beds to supplicate. تَدْعُونَ رَبَّهُمْ خَوْفًا وَطَمَعًا وَمِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ. SubhanAllah. That they seek Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They supplicate to Allah out of seeking that which He has. And they also fear for the adab that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has put for the sinners. And they also spend in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Just like the sunnah was of many of our imams that at night, they would go out with those sacks and they would distribute. And they would give sadaqat to people during a time when nobody would know who it was. Sadaqat al-sir. طيب. In addition to this, milhu al-layl wa milhu al-sahar, the best part, the seasoning, the flavoring of sahar, of the ibadat and the kinds of worship, the acts of worship that a person can carry out during this time is Salatul Layl. The night prayer. Salatul Layl, our Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, when he was giving the wasaya to Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam, three times he repeated and he says, wa alayka bi salatul layl. Three times. Wa alayka bi salatul layl ya Ali. Salatul Layl is something that is really, really important. It is something that we need to strengthen our wills. Need to try to make that decision. Resolution. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Seek the wasila and the tawassul, the intercession of Sayyidah Zahra salamullahi alayha. Seek the intercession of Our Lady. That please pray for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give me that resolve so that every day I can get up for that salat. If you pray it once, you will feel the feeling. You will feel it. And when you do, it's going to be addictive. It is going to be addictive. To the extent that you will not be able to leave it. Salat al-Layl was wajib for Rasulullah. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, he had certain ahkam that was special for him. Even the rest of the imams alayhi salam did not have those ahkam. And one of them was this, that Salat al-Layl was wajib on Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. Sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. Sayyidina Ali al-Qadir, radwanallahi ta'ala alayhim, he was related to Al-Allama al-Tabatabai. Al-Allama al-Tabatabai, his family name is also Al-Qadi. Muhammad Hussein al-Qadi al-Tabatabai. When Al-Allama al-Tabatabai was a youth, he was in Najaf, he was studying, and he used to go and frequent to the akhlaq classes of Sayyidina Ali al-Qadi. So once Sayyidina Ali al-Qadi was coming, Al-Allama al-Tabatabai was on the street, Sayyidina Ali al-Qadi looked at him and he came towards him and he put his hand on the shoulder of Sayyidina Ali, the youth. He was still young during that time. He told him, my son, if you want the dunya, then you have to pray Salat al-Layl. If you want the akhirah, you have to pray Salat al-Layl. There are so many benefits to Salat al-Layl. Yesterday I was saying that it is necessary for us to be chaste, to be pure. Brothers and sisters, do not only focus on our facial appearance, our external appearance, haircut, face, however. If you look at the riwayat and the benefits of Salat al-Layl, you'll find that the substitute for all of this is found in our ibadat. Look at some of the benefits of Salat al-Layl. I will just count some of them, because there are so many I can't even go to the narrations. First of all, they remove any diseases, they keep diseases away from the body. They also keep a person's body healthy in general. Diseases are away, the body in general is energetic and it's strong. They brighten the face, and this is, of course, I think many of you already have heard in our narrations. They brighten the face and they beautify the face. If you look at the description of Shuhada in Karbala, Ali al-Akbar salamullah alayhi al-Qasim, some of the narratives, when they say, on the other side, normally you would think that they would not be impartial. I mean, they would be taking the side of the Umayyads. They would describe them maybe in a way that is not befitting to them. They say that, for example, a youth came out of the camp of Imam Hussain alayhi salam, whose face was so bright, it looked like the moon. It had so much nur on it. Even that person who attacked Sayyidah Zahra salamullah alayhi, when he was boasting and writing it in that letter to Muawiyah, he says that after I kicked that door and I went inside, I was faced by a bright light that blinded me. I was faced by a bright light of Sayyidah Zahra salamullah alayhi that blinded me. This is Salat al-Layl, my dear brothers and sisters. Sometimes when you find some of our ulama who have such an appearance, know where this comes from. This is the secret. Salat al-Layl also, it helps the akhlaq of a person become better. In addition to the body order, it changes. This is mentioned by many of our ulama. In addition to the fact that it brings rizq and sustenance, the paths and the doors of our rizq, they open when we pray Salat al-Layl. In addition to the fact that they strengthen the eyes and they also assist a person, I mean some of the effects, to fulfill their loans and their debts, etc. Many, many of the different fawaid. Another thing that we can learn from Sayyidah Zahra salamullah alayhi, Our Lady of Light, she abided by the narration of Rasulullah that he who dies without knowing the Imam of their time has truly died a death of Jahiliyyah, correct? She knew her Imam in terms of a person. She knew the characteristics of her Imam. She had true knowledge of her Imam. However, this is something we can learn from the Sayyidah Zahra salamullah alayhi. She had a direct connection to her Imam. We today know who our Imam is. Imam al-Hujjah salamullahi alayhi. Ajal Allah ta'ala farajahu al-sharif. Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa ala Muhammad. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hasten his reappearance and make us amongst his sincerest followers. Our Imam alayhi salam, we know him, we know his person, we know many of his characteristics and the levels of ma'rifah, the cognition and the cognitive spiritual knowledge, it differs from person to a person according to how strong our relation is. However, our Imam alayhi salam, we do not have any direct connection to him. Our Imam right now, he is living in the time of al-ghaiba. Al-Imam al-Khumayni radwanullahi ta'ala alayhi, when he pondered over Islam, over ahkam, over the different tenets and the different aspects of Islamic Sharia, he came to the understanding that our time, even if the Imam alayhi salam, he is in al-ghaiba, there has to be an authority, there has to be a person, there has to be somebody who is a deputy, a general deputy of our Imam alayhi salam, not the four special deputies. There has to be a general deputy. These are our fuqaha, and Imam Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhi, he postulated the theory of Wilayat al-Faqih. And this theory, since our Imam al-Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhi, he brought this. And alhamdulillah, in Iran, the Islamic revolution was victorious. The situation of Muslims, and especially the followers of Ahlulbayt alayhi salam, it totally changed. The people, the oppressed Muslims, the oppressed people of Palestine were one of the first people who immediately landed after the victory of the Islamic revolution in Iran. And if you continue to look, I mean, they passed many of some of the shuhada will be mentioned. They were during that time of the war between the Ba'athist and Iran. And some of the barakat and some of the karamat, may Allah bless the Sayyid, he mentioned them. That special connection with Sayyidah Zahra salamullahi alayha. That special relation with them. This particular path, my dear brothers and sisters, if we want to follow the true wilaya of Imam al-Hujjah alayhi salam, this is such a path that has divine support and madad in it. These some of the stories that Sayyid has mentioned, these are really important. We have to take them in mind in our heart. Even the Islamic revolution itself, Sahib al-Zaman alayhi salam was guiding Imam Khomeini. And it is not only during that time, it's even after that. But I'll mention a couple of stories from the beginning of the Islamic revolution that I have. First of all, one of them I've heard from one of my teachers, and the other, of course, I've read, written by one of the people who, actually by the driver who drove Imam Khomeini from the airport to, when he first arrived. Because he was one of the special companions, or one of the people who was always in the company of Imam Khomeini, radhiyallahu ta'ala. So the first part, the first of it is that Imam al-Khomeini, radhiyallahu ta'ala, when he first arrived to Tehran, during that time he was residing in a school. Our Imam, during this time, of course, there were certain people who were taking care of him, because in the very beginning, the situation was such that the Shah had left, but there was still martial law. So there were certain figures in the army who were still imposing curfews, etc. Now, Imam Khomeini, during this time, there were many people, Mu'mineen, who were taking care of his protection. So the Imam was residing temporarily in the school. During one of those nights, one of the guards in the room of Imam al-Khomeini started to hear sounds as if there is people talking to each other. And as he knew, he remembered that Imam Khomeini was by himself. So he wanted to come to see. He almost reached the window. When he reached the window, he froze. He could not move anymore. All of a sudden, and he could not move anymore. He was just about to look at the window. He froze, he couldn't move anymore. At that, he saw that the sounds, the voices, they've stopped. Imam Khomeini, radhiyallahu ta'ala, he comes outside and he tells him that even though you are protecting me, you're guarding me, but you do not have the permission to come and eavesdrop. So keep that in mind. Who is Imam Khomeini, radhiyallahu ta'ala, speaking to? And even clearer, and this is from my own teacher that I heard that, and of course I think many of you also may know this story, that when the Imam, when he arrived in Tehran in the beginning, the curfew was imposed. So people are not allowed to go out in the streets at a certain time. And they had threatened that whoever was to go out, they were going to be killed. Imam Khomeini, he gave that fatwa. And he said, it is now haram for people to stay at home. It is haram. There was a danger of being shot, of massacre. So one of the ulama, he picks up the phone, he calls Imam Khomeini. And he tells him, oh Imam, you have given this fatwa for people to leave, for people to go outside. So many people are going to be killed. Who is going to bear the shara'i responsibility for all of this blood? Imam Khomeini tells him, this order has come from higher up, from a higher place. At that, the person who was with that second alim, he says that alim, the phone dropped from his hand. And he got up saying, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. And it became known that had he, Imam Khomeini, not given that fatwa for people to leave outside, the entire Islamic revolution was going to be crushed. That was the plan that they, that the army had during that time. This path, my dear brothers and sisters, we have to stay by it. One of the manifestations of this path is the fact that this is a way, a pathway to Sahib al-Zaman, Ajallah Ta'ala Farajul Sharif. Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa ala Muhammadin wa ala Muhammad. These majalis that I see before me, and this perfection in the way that these majalis are held, and the perfection in terms of all of the plannings, truly embodies that hadith that says, I believe from Imam Ali alayhi salam, that رحم الله امرأ عامل عملا فأتقنه. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have mercy on a person who does something and he perfects it. Today, as we follow this path of Wilayat al-Faqih, that path of Imam Khomeini, the path of Sayyid al-Qa'id, my dear brothers and sisters, one of the most beautiful things in this path is that it has strategic thought and planning to truly try to pave the way for the reappearance of the 12th Imam alayhi salam. Not that we will continue to live if it happens, alhamdulillah. Because this society in general, this society or this Muslim community, our ummah, the followers of Ahlulbayt alayhi salam, the Imam alayhi salam, let us try to think strategically, logically. He went into ghaibah because of the fact that there were certain dangers. There were certain insufficiencies in us in trying to face these dangers, either protecting him from them or ourselves. Khair, that we strategically need to study them. Strategically in the sense that there is a need for some of our youth that don't only go to the universities and go and study IT and software programming or banking or accounts or I've become a dentist or this and that. Humanities are really important as well. Even if you just do a master's degree at least, or you take a few modules, we need to have strategic management and planning. Knowing scientifically how to learn or how to run community practices, how to be able to totally plan our approach to paving the way for the reappearance of the Imam alayhi salam. Do we work, whatever we do, do we normally have statistics? Do we have descriptive statistics? Not only numbers, no, even the people, the quality of these statistics, the people that we take, do we know them? Do we know, for example, our youth, how many of us are there? Our general trends, what is the percentage of our youth who truly are practicing, who are not? Brothers and sisters, how many sisters, for example, observe hijab or not? Do we have statistics, for instance, of how many students we have who have studied Islamic sciences? And in proportion to the general community, how many per sheikh or per talib alim, how many people, how many mu'mineen do we have? Is it healthy? Is it according to him, is it a healthy statistic? That is to say, in poorer countries, less developed countries, we find that per doctor, there is a huge number of patients. In more developed countries, it's less. That we need to see that many, many different aspects and different things need to be planned. It should not be that certain good, until today, this unfortunately can be seen in the Hausa, this can be seen in our Islamic world as well. The fact that sometimes, a lot of the times, the good efforts that we see from certain individuals are only individual efforts. They have gone through the trouble in order to reach whatever place that they have reached. Be it a reciter or a talib alim or person with many different skills. We need to plan, and I'm not only talking about the framework of this organization, but I'm talking about our communities in general. We need to think about the fact that we should start now to scientifically produce. Yani, there is a need for this, we need to give incentives to our youth that you should do this. How many hafidhin of Quran, of the Holy Quran, do we have in our Shia world or in our Shia communities in the UK? How many hafidhin? We, mashallah, in terms of the Shias, we must at least be 500,000 or more. Our brothers, the Ahlul Sunnah, mashallah, they have many hafidhin. They have schools, Quranic schools in many different cities. In each city, they have that. How many professional reciters do we have? One of the things that, of course, I was discussing yesterday with some of the mu'mineen was the fact that reciting and listening to latmiyat, even in English, this is something that is necessary. We may find it difficult today to connect because of the fact that we grew up with a different language, number one. But do not think that before us, our ancestors, whether they be Farsi speaking or Urdu speaking, whatever other language, except for Arabic, because they took that directly from the Imams, alayhi wasalam. But whoever of us who speaks other languages, know and understand that there was one generation that started, that reared and made the second generation, their children, learn certain qasa'id, certain words, certain phrases that they started to connect them with the masa'ib of Ashura. Some of these qasa'id, like I said, in Arabic, alhamdulillah, many of them were recited even in the presence of our Imams, alayhi wasalam. There is a necessity for some of our youth, brothers and sisters, to study English literature, to compose. And these compositions or these poems, they need to be distributed amongst reciters to be recited, or to have unified translations of some of the original and really important qasa'id, like the qasida of Da'bil in the presence of Imam al-Rada salamullahi alayhi, a unified one, and for it to be recited, so that this younger generation, when they now, for example, hear this particular word from the qasida, khalas, they know the connection, that image is in their hearts. This is one of the benefits of this path, to think and to have this kind of pioneering thought. Sallallahu ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. My dear brothers and sisters, I would like to end with one matter. One of the things that we need to learn from Sayyidah Zahra salamullahi alayha is her aza and her grief and sorrow for Sayyidah Shuhada. That when the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, when Sayyidah Shuhada was still young, he informed her what was going to happen to Imam Hussein salamullahi alayhi. She started to weep and she started to grieve. At that, our Holy Prophet, he mentioned all of the ajr that was going to be given to those people who are going to, first of all, support Sayyidah Shuhada. And those, he also informed Sayyidah Nisa'al Alameen, Sayyidah Zahra, of us, those people who are going to mourn for Sayyidah Shuhada generation after generation. But the question is, now, unfortunately, this is especially with regards to the youth, maybe some, I mean others, we're not used to truly grieving, truly crying. In some of our narrations, when you look at when a qasida was recited in the presence of our Imam alayhi salam, the Imams would cry with a loud voice, not only shedding tears and quietly crying, they would cry with a loud voice. And this is something, me having traveled and seen many different communities, this is something that I find, especially in many different communities in the East, in the Middle East. One of the communities that extremely strikes me is the community of Hijaz. When I hear many of the majalis being recited over there, the mu'mineen over there, they are not ashamed to raise their voices in crying. One of the ashab by the name of Al-Fudail, during the time of Imam al-Sadiq salamullah alayhi, and it seems that this incident that took place could have been during the later time when the security situation had become a little bit difficult. Fudail goes to Imam alayhi salam, having had a majlis, he had held a majlis one day before. But he had not told Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam about it. So Imam al-Sadiq salamullahi alayhi, he asks him, "Oh Fudail, where were you yesterday?" Fudail, he does not say anything. The Imam tells him that, "Oh Fudail, did you not have a majlis yesterday for Imam Hussein alayhi salam, for my grandfather?" He said, "Yes, I did." Fudail before had said that I had been occupied, preoccupied. Imam tells him, "Did you not have a majlis?" He said, "Yes, I did." He told him, "And I was there as well. I didn't see you, O Imam. He says, yes, I was sitting. Did you not stumble upon a white cloth? I said, yes. I said, that was me sitting. I told him, O Imam, why were you sitting by the door? He said, because of the fact that my grandmother, Sayyida Zahra, salamullahi alayha, she was at the front of the majlis, and in respect for her, I stayed behind. The other imams, if we see how they would cry for Sayyida Shuhada, this is my advice to my brothers, mu'mineen, brothers and sisters, when we weep for Sayyida Shuhada, try to connect, try to think about the image, try to put yourself in that same position of Sayyida Shuhada, of Sayyida Zahra, of how difficult it would be to see your children being oppressed and being hit and being struck and being killed in such a gruesome way. And Imam As-Sadiq alayhi salam, one of the narrators by the name of As-Sakun, he came to our Imam alayhi salam and he looked to be depressed. Imam alayhi salam asks him, O Sakuni, what is wrong with you? As-Sakuni says, I have had a daughter. And unfortunately during that time, they would think that if they would have daughters, it was something that was not good. They would be upset. Our Imam alayhi salam tells him, O Sakuni, why are you so gloomy? You should be happy. O Sakuni, know that her weight is on the ground. It is not, you do not have to carry her. Her rizq is on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. She's going to live her own life. She's not taking your life from you, your days. And she is eating her own rizq. What have you named her, O Sakuni? Sakuni says, I have named her Fatima. Imam As-Sadiq alayhi salam, he turns towards the Sakuni and having put his hand on his forehead, Imam alayhi salam says, And the Imam's situation, his heart, his emotions, they change. Imam tells him, O Sakuni, now that you have named her Fatima, do not curse her, do not swear at her, and do not hit her. Our Imam alayhi salam, he was remembering his grandmother, Sayyida Zahra salamullahi alayha, when she was hit by that person and who did not give any attention, pay any care to her position in front of Rasulullah, to this Aziza, this dear daughter of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. My dear brothers and sisters, after the martyrdom of Sayyida Zahra, after the martyrdom of the Lady of Light, Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam, he had finished giving her ghusl. At that, he turns towards his children. He turns towards his children and he tells them, Oh Hassan, Oh Hussein, Oh Zainab, Oh Kulthum, and Oh Fadda, come to bid your mother farewell. Come to bid her farewell, to have a final look at your mother. Because this is separation and we are going to meet her again in Jannah. Our imams and Ashab al-Kisra, Imam Hussein alayhi salam, Imam al-Hassan, Sayyida Zainab, all of them, they rushed towards the Sayyida Zahra's body, weeping. Some of the Arbab al-Maqatil, some of the Arbab al-Manabir, they narrate this, that Sayyida Zahra alayhi salam, as she was laying down there, they say that Imam Hussein alayhi salam, he weeps so much that all of a sudden there was a voice, a sound of crying that was coming from the body of Sayyida Zahra. Some of them even mentioned that the hands of Sayyida Zahra extended as she embraced Imam Hussein. قضيت قضيت ومصاب ما مر شبيها
مامار شبيها بجوا سبطانها وشبقوا عليها عليها حنت شبقتهم بديها وهتف بالعريش نحيهم يا ابو حسين يا حيدر شيل سبطان الزجية شيل حسين يا حيدر وخويا وخويا أرضها والسما حنت أرضها والسما حنت سوية الفقد مضعة الهادي وينحب الدين الفقد مضعة الهادي هي وينحب الدين.
By Allah, my dear brothers and sisters, if you think of Zainab Salamullahi alayha, her situation, this young daughter who was always used to her mother, to looking at her, to being around her, put yourself in that position. Think about your own child if you have such a small daughter. Sayyidah Zahra alayha salam, she has been put in the coffin now. As the night has come and people have fallen asleep, Imam Ali alayhi salam, he raises the coffin to leave from the house. As the children are looking at the coffin of their mother, I think this is how the heart of Sayyidah Zainab must have been saying, what it must have been saying. By Allah, Zainab cried and wailed, don't bury, do not bury our mother under the ground. My home will become darker for me, Father, after life, after her life. I have lost happiness. They lifted her coffin, my dear brothers and sisters. All of the women, they were weeping. Sayyidah Zainab alayha salam from behind. It seems she was calling, oh Father, I ask you, please walk slowly. Do not take my mother so quickly to her qab. Sayyidah Zahra alayha salam, she was now being taken towards her grave. My dear brothers and sisters, but there's a couple of things I want to look at. Sayyidah Zahra alayha salam, as she was leaving, this special grief that she had in her heart for Imam Hussein salamullahi alayhi, when she was speaking to Rasulullah, she was telling him that, oh Father, who is going to be crying over him if I am not going to be around? I tell you, oh Sayyidah Zahra, do not worry, because Umm al-Baneen alayhi salam, she was there to weep for Imam al-Hussein. Umm al-Baneen, when she entered the house of Imam Ali, she told Imam Ali, I cannot enter the house that Sayyidah Zahra lived in as a wife. Please do consider me to be your servant and the servant of Zahra's children. Abu al-Fadl Abbas, when he was born, she taught him from the beginning to never call Hussein brother. He would always refer to him as Ya Sayyidi, my master. When Sayyidah Zainab returns back to Al-Madinah, she holds a majlis and she tells the servant to not let anybody inside. All of a sudden, there is a knock, my dear brothers and sisters, on the door of Sayyidah Zainab's house. This servant lady, she responds, who is it behind? Not knowing who she was, she went to Sayyidah Zainab to ask if she would let her in. Sayyidah Zainab tells her, yes, do let her in. This is Umm al-Baneen. She shares with us all of our griefs. But I tell you to look at this particular stanza. Umm al-Baneen, as she entered, she raised her hands. And Sayyidah Zainab raised her hands, telling her, wa Abbas.
Sayyidina Zainab was saying, "Wa Abbasa," but look at the response of Umm al-Baneen. She turned to Zainab and said, "Wa Husayna, wa Shayna."